Aloha, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to The Experience, and welcome to 2019. This is the first show of 2019, and I guess I should probably front-load this with a huge announcement. There's going to be a big change on this show starting in February. It is going to be a two-hour show, and it is only going to be monthly. So it's going to be a monthly spectacular, is kind of how I look at it. Because as longtime listeners know, I am also running a website called OurUndoing.com. And from that, of course, I've got the free podcast, Our Undoing Radio. And thank you, everyone who's been listening to that. We're wrapping up season one. I guess next week is the last episode. Next week is the last episode of season one. So thank you, everyone, for listening. And if you would like to listen, head on over to iTunes, Our Undoing Radio. Plop it in your feed and get going before we hit season two. Not that you'll need to, they're not sequential or anything. It's not like you need to listen to one to listen to the other. In any event, there's a lot more going on at OurUndoing.com than just the podcast. And so I need to dedicate more time to that website, especially doing live events here at the home. We just did a talk with Willie Iokea that was really successful. And so essentially now I've got that email list. Now I've stolen all of my friends' email lists of people who would show up to such an event. And so I've got them trapped. I mean, we offer like free food and free talk story. What could be better? So I will be videotaping that and audio taping that and producing stuff for OurUndoing.com. So if you're not a member, do consider becoming one. There already are a book's worth of essays. In fact, there is an audiobook version of my book Urgency on there as well. Lots of audio, lots of video, stuff you will not find anywhere else on the internet. I'm very much hard at work there, but I need to be harder at work there, I feel. I feel like this, if any work is important in life, and I'm not sure that it necessarily is, but this feels like it's the closest thing that's going to qualify for me. So I must pursue it. But I certainly don't want to give up the experience. So I think it could best be served by doing a two-hour monthly spectacular. I don't know what, Ice Capades or something. I don't know what it will be like. Do they even have Ice Capades anymore? I don't know. So look forward to that. Come join me at Our Undoing. If not, relax. You will hear me here. I'll continue on with this. And Whitley will be rolling out a new show with a different host as well. You're going to ultimately, I think, be getting more bang for your buck. Now, one more thing on this. I would love to go out with a bang. Stop doing the weekly format with a listener roundtable. And I know many of you have been clamoring to be on a listener roundtable. So clamor one more time so I can get a head count. Let's do a listener roundtable. Like, let's record it in the next week or so from the time of this being published. And let's have that be the final episode of the weekly show as we start anew and go monthly with the experience. Okay, speaking of roundtables, we have a live roundtable for you this week with some new neighbors. I think I told you, did I tell you that I met neighbors, new people who have moved to the island, who are friends with William Henry, and like how weird that is, because I originally came on to Unknown Country when William Henry retired his show here. So how odd is it that I would then meet like friends of his? And friends of theirs who are now, they've all had experiences of one sort or another and wanted to do a roundtable. And so today you will be introduced to James Knight, who is the creator of a new form of yoga called Gentle Somatic Yoga. Some of you may have heard of it, but you can find out all about that at his website, www.gentlesomaticyoga.com. And a good friend of his, who just happened to be on the island this week, And I apparently is sort of reclusive or media shy or something. So it was kind of a big deal to his friends that he actually wanted to come on the show. Like, I guess he had maybe Google searched me or something, but he'd read about me and said, yeah, I think I trust that guy to ask me questions. So good. I'm glad he did. His name is Excalibur, by the way, and we will get into how that name came to be. His website is xmarksthespot.com, and that is exmarksthespot.com. So don't just put an X, it's EX. And he does intuitive counseling, shamanic healing, core belief sessions, these types of things. So if that is your bag, man, head on over to xmarksthespot.com. Also joining us is Shay Trias. And I hope I'm not mispronouncing her name. Her last name is T-R-I-A-S. So it's either Trias or Trias or somewhere in there. I hope I'm not butchering it. What I am butchering is her website, because I don't have her info just yet. So as of this recording, I'm sorry, Shay, I can't advertise you. I looked her up on the internet and I couldn't find it. And I know she's like flying back home at the moment. So I tried to get it from James, and he sent me like a, I don't know what it is, like an info card, but the info card on my end only shows up with her name, and I don't feel like bothering him because he's had so many guests, so I don't want to be like, can you please get me this? So, you know what, it's not a big deal. I Google searched her, and I could find other things like YouTube and Pinterest and all that stuff for her, but no actual website, so I'm just going to assume, because even in the conversation about, hey, do you guys want to put your websites up, it seemed to be an afterthought for her, so it's probably not a big deal. So I don't feel that bad, but I feel a little bad. Bad enough that, Shay, when you hear this, if you give me your website, I will gladly apologize more awkwardly next week and post your website. Give you a little advertisement for it. Okay, so what are we mainly going to be talking about? Well, as you know, I don't like talking about what we're going to talk about so much because you're going to hear it. I mean, who wants spoilers, right? Well, you know who likes spoilers? Actually, my wife, Carol, who completes the roundtable. So it is her birthday today. So in her honor, I will give some spoilers. We're going to talk about ET contact. What do we mean by ET contact? Sounds like we should mean aliens. I wonder if we do. We're also going to be talking about ghostly encounters and about just how personal this all is. And for you psychonauts out there, we're going to get into a little bit of the psychedelia as well. One thing I will say up front here is I would love to have all these people back on the show. There's a lot of stuff that sounds awful familiar to things I've experienced that that I just had a glance over because it's a round table, and so you can't just talk to one person for an hour unless you're doing like an FBI interrogation. But sadly, that's not at all what this is. So, all right, that is the preamble. Glad to be back on the air with you. One more slight apology, I guess, is the audio quality, because it is a live roundtable and because we are in Hawaii, where we have to have the windows and doors open. You're going to hear some wind in the background and some other noises. I think you hear me crinkle a bottle and then cringe at how much noise I'm making, but nothing that overpowers anyone's voices or anything like that. So I think ultimately, I was able to drown out a lot of it in the editing, and I don't think it will impair your enjoyment, but I think sometimes when you're not prepared for background noise, all you can hear is the background noise. So if I warn you up front, you'll be prepared. All right, non-subscribers, you have even more time to prepare, because we will get to the interview right after these messages. Subscribers, are you prepared? Let's hear from Carol's and my new friends right now. Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge,
if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at ourundoing.com.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant, but then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
Aloha, ladies and gentlemen. It is Jeremy Vaney, and we are here for a live roundtable. This is exciting because this never happens. So let's go around the table and everyone give us your names, starting to my left.
Okay. Hi, this is James Knight, and I live here in Nalehu on the Big Island.
Okay.
And I'm Carol, Jeremy's wife. So you may have heard about me.
Yes.
Okay. I'm Shay. I'm a visitor to the Big Island, staying with James.
And I'm Christopher Emmer, a.k.a. Excalibur, and I live everywhere, and I'm visiting the Big Island again.
Excellent. And so that is a good place for us to start, because there is a whole lot going on with your name slash names. You were, I guess, born into the name Christopher and then adopted the name Excalibur because why?
Well, as it turned out, there was way back in the 60s, 70s, maybe 80s, a group called ET Earth Mission. And they were a group that actually took over 3 astrologers' bodies and brought through all these teachings and technologies as walk-ins and then left. They brought exercises that they called technologies. And one of them was, well, I don't know what it was called because it was, like, well, it was back when I was living in Maui in the 80s. But one of the exercises is a lot of toning, and then say who you are and why you're here. And I thought, well, I'm ready to do this in a workshop. I should try it myself.
What is toning?
Toning is making sounds that just naturally sort of come out of your being.
Okay.
Elevating, changing the frequency, basically. So in that, I said, I just opened up, and what came through was, I'm Excalibur. I'm a sword of truth for those who would seek it deep within, and I'm here to bring the planet to its true destiny.
Hmm.
And I was kind of like, okay. And then I've been an intuitive consultant for a long time, so I worked with guides and stuff, and they were like, you've got to embrace that name. And
do you always trust that?
My guides?
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
All of it, any of it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I have since I was 16.
What do you think would have happened if you didn't?
Oh, nothing. It would just been one parallel reality where I didn't.
Okay. So you legally changed your name to Excalibur then?
Yes, it was like part of the embracing process. And I was living in Hawaii then, and it worked because everybody changes their name in Hawaii, and it wasn't a bad, you know, it was an easy process.
Did your family have a problem with that, and did you care if they did?
No. No, I was one of 10 kids, and, you know, we were kind of all crazy individuals, so it wasn't freaky to them.
Huh. And can I ask what was going on in your life at the time that that happened?
Well, I was living on Big Island, and I was having tons and tons of ET contact up off the grid in Hualoa.
And was that did you just start living off the grid, or had you been there a while?
Well, actually, it was the time James came into my life, and I was bouncing back and forth between Maui and Big Island. So it was actually both.
Okay, interesting. And so this connects to something that happened with you, right? You have some sort of mutual ET contact story.
I do, definitely. But this particular one, at least I've had several with Christopher. In fact, it probably happens more than when I don't even know it. But one day we were getting together, Christopher, Excalibur, myself, and a friend, Hani, and please help with the story, because this is how I remember it, is that we had decided, we had rented out a house in Kuoko Beach, which is just down from Waimea, for a couple of days. And we were set out to make contact with the ET, with ETs. And I was sharing with Christopher recently, like, I feel uncomfortable using that term, because my experiences, I've had like four major experiences where it's nothing like anything I've really heard through popular media. You know, they're not in solid forms. They don't have eyes. They're not human. And for me, they've been light and vibration. So, but that's the word I use just to describe it, because I don't have a better word.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
It's more like light, energy, angelic-ish, uh-huh, without the wings.
Okay.
So anyways, we had rented this house, and I think we were out to make contact. We were going out to the island looking for places to set up and call them in for an experience.
Now, why is that?
Because it's a passion of mine. Consciousness has always been a passion of mine, and being a longtime yogi and being in the healing arts for over 25 years, I choose to put myself in situations to learn more of who I am and to make to bring access to more parts of myself. So studying shamanism and opening, you know, brainwave biofeedback and meditation, things like that.
Do you, when you're a yogi, do you run in yogi circles? Like, do you know other yogis?
Because I've branded my own style of yoga called gentle somatic yoga, the short answer is no, because it's a different style of yoga. And, but I do belong to a community of people that think alike and resonate, like here at Excalibur. You know, I feel like I have a lot of people in my life, Shay, as well. There is a community around me that has similar experiences and similar culture, mm-hmm, but it's not necessarily the tradition of yoga culture.
Right, yeah, because I'm always interested in if, you know, yogis, the Dalai Lama, Eckhart Tolle, you know, like various people who speak about things that are, you would think would lead to this, but then they never quite get there. And I always wondered if they've had experiences, if in private they talk about, you know, they've had these sort of alien or whatever you want to call them experiences.
Yeah.
And the closest I've gotten to that is Peter Kingsley.
Okay.
I don't know if you guys are familiar with him, but he, you know, just I had a friend who was having encounters with a cloaked being. And Peter Kingsley, he wrote a book called Reality. He's written a bunch of books about essentially how Western rationality that came to dominate the world, the Westernized mind, was a mistranslation of a poem from way back when that was actually given by a nameless goddess, and so that there actually is an esoteric part of it that has just gone missing. So I just asked him, you ever hear of shrouded beings? You know, does this resonate with you at all? And he just said, well, what was the color of the shroud? Because the color of the shroud dictates where the being's from. And I was like, wow, I wonder if these other guys would all say that, and gals, you know, who never talk about beings and interdimensional and all that stuff, if they all are that familiar. So
I think my awareness started shifting through learning Vipassana meditation when I was 19. I had some altered states that, or some expanded states that some people might call like samadhi, like difference, where I just dissolved into oneness through bliss. It was an actual embodied state of myself into oneness, and I was pretty young. And then shortly after that, I started studying with Native American Indians. And so doing ceremonies like sweat lodges or vision quests, you know, working with the elements. And then that expanded my experience into tapping into more of the mystery of, so, you know, at a really young age, I started having big experiences through seeing myself in different ways. Hmm. You know, does that make sense?
Yeah. For sure.
So I think that really affected me as a yogi. I mean, a yogi's union, right? And that's why I use the word. So it's bringing all parts of myself into alignment. Then I expanded to more possibility of understanding who I am.
Mm-hmm.
So, but those things really influenced, especially shamanism, and even using substances, plants, medicines, exploring myself through those avenues allow kind of, I can see that that has helped open me to invite these experiences in. They're not paranormal, they're more normal.
Well, let me ask you, and this goes for anyone who has that, the experience of learning about native cultures, heart cultures, and all of that, is there, would you get something different out of it if you were of that culture? In other words, is there something about you that has to be Lakota, has to be Hawaiian, has to be whatever that is, to understand fully what they're saying, what they're talking about? Or can you actually learn it as a white guy going into these cultures and with your best intentions?
It's always been my choice to dismantle belief systems and dogmas. You know, I can accept people's choices, but for me personally, it's never been my value to need to believe something to have an experience. So, so the answer is no, I don't think you need to be, I get to be myself, you know, and allow myself to interpret what it means, but leaning on the tradition that I'm experiencing it through. So if it's a Native American Indian, I'm on a vision quest, I'm having an experience, I go back, I share with the shaman, they give me back their interpretation, and then, you know, it's up to me then to decide what's true of that. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So I think I'm not gullible in regards to believing something outside, but I receive it as information, and then I see how my body feels about that, and that's kind of how it keeps expanding.
Okay.
Does that resonate?
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay.
And so Shay, do you have
moisture in Hawaii?
That was not Shay, by the way.
I have not had any experience with any outworldly beings.
What about just any sort of quote unquote paranormal or synchronistic, anything like that type experiences?
Well, I don't know about paranormal. I mean, well, you know, when my grandma passed, you know, things happened, and I knew it was her. And recently, the other night, I think it was the first night I was here, or second night, I was trying to go to sleep, and I felt somebody above me, and I opened my eyes, and there was a man staring at me, and he heard me scream. Mm-hmm. So I didn't know what that was. It was really weird. So I'm kind of, every night when I go to bed now, I'm like, okay, mm-hmm. There's a lot of wind here in South Point. Is it me? Am I tripping out? Is he coming? And then he keeps talking about the little mini who. So I'm like, are they running around the property? Because I hear all these noises, you know, because it's spiritual out here. We're on magic land.
Yeah.
So, you know, I just kind of like, you know, it's the Catholic in me. Like, okay, don't scare me. Don't do anything weird. I believe in you. Okay.
That's interesting because, so Willie Iaukea came and gave a talk, and he's been on the show before. And he was talking about night marchers, which are the other sort of big lore. And basically he explained, you know, night marchers are warriors who agreed to be here when they were alive. They agreed to stick around and protect the land and all of that stuff. And so sometimes they will confront you or get in your face or whatever, and you don't back down. You know, if they do that and you don't back down, that's fine. But also if you ask them, what is it that you want? You know, maybe you'll get an answer, and maybe they actually are coming to you because they need something from you. So okay. The way he talked about it, it's interesting because it's like, right, we get so in this culture, we get so just into horror movie mode about things that it's like, oh, wait, these are people and they agreed to be here. So but the downside of agreeing to be here, apparently, is that there's no, you know, when the Hawaiian culture got broken up, someone in their family lineage within generations is supposed to release them. And without those people to even know it, because they've been Christianized or whatever, they aren't in touch with that part of their themselves or their culture. They don't know how to do that. So there are all these spirits just hanging out, and some of them want to be here, and some of them are like, time to go home. So I guess maybe if that ever happens, maybe you ask them what they want, and if they're like, which way is home? You say, go to the light or something.
Don't stand over me when I'm sleeping and scare me.
Yeah. So, Excalibur, which happened for you first, would you say? ET contact or spirit guide stuff?
Boy. Because I was about 10 when I started having ET contact. And I didn't know that's what it was. So, to me, it's kind of all blended.
What was the contact, and how did you know?
Well, that would happen at night. And I'd wake up in that sort of a paralyzed state where I couldn't move. But that's all I knew. But I remember also telling my parents that for some reason I had a date with the ETs and I'd packed my tent and I was going off to the woods. And they were like, great, have a good time. And all I remember is the next day sort of being in an altered state on walkabout and not remembering a whole lot until later when I did some regressions.
Okay. Carol?
Yes?
Anything you want to add? I don't
want to... No, I just find all this fascinating. I feel like there's a thread here with all these different experiences. But at the same time, I'm not quite sure what it is. Like I'm like it's like right there, but not sure.
Okay.
Because it seems all different, but it's not.
Well, let me ask you this about regressions. If someone were to say to you, those regressions were imagination, but there is a reality there. Would you be able to live with that? Like, would you still have the same feeling about what you experienced if you had to do away with what came out of regression? Or would that be offensive?
Well, I don't think I could ever do away with it, but I could certainly allow it to be a parallel reality that I'm not immersed in.
Okay.
You know, and I think that's actually my perception of what a lot of ET contact is right now. It's aspects of ourselves that we're finally willing to recognize, and they may be in various time frames and all of that, and that's that consciousness piece that we're starting to finally play with is what's allowing us to embrace the idea.
Well, that's interesting. So when you say ET contact, you're not necessarily talking about something alien and completely foreign. It may be something closer to home.
Alien is a word I'll never use.
Okay, so it's just a placeholder, really. Yeah. Very good.
Yeah, same for me. And may I continue the story of when we rented the house?
Yeah, sure.
Because this is a wonderful place to talk about this, and especially with Excalibur here, because we haven't really reviewed it very much.
We'll be back after this.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
You know, The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And the Afterlife Revolution is going to open the door for you so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle. It's available in paperback. And there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something. You can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, Anne Streber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to The Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world.
Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Streber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Streber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Streber.com.
Welcome back.
So one day it was Hani and me and Christopher Excalibur, and we were on these hammocks during the day. And I remember vaguely going out and planting crystals or doing some work on the land close near there. Am I combining stories?
Yeah. Because there's a thing previous to this that I think is important. Because we were setting our intention for days around this contact. And Hani had a dream. And in the dream, the ETs came to him and wanted to take James with them. And Hani was very protective, and he said, no, you can't. And they said, well, pointed at me. And I said, well, what about him? And he's like, well, you can take him, but you have to have him back by 6 a.m.
What's it like being second fiddle?
Yeah.
That's not right.
You know, that was his dream, but he remembered it crystal clear. And since we were in this gathering time of setting our intention, it was we were just sort of like, wow, they're coming. Anyways, continue.
No, thank you, because these are the pieces that I wanted to remember. So we're hanging out on these hammocks near Puuco Beach, on Puuco Beach, and I had gone in to get something in the kitchen, and I'm looking out the window, and with my eye, no, first I heard this rattling sound in the house, like doors kind of shuttering, windows shuttering, and other noises in the house. And I started looking around. And I thought that was unusual. And I look out towards them on the hammocks, and the palm trees are starting to wave around and almost even touch the ground to where they were sitting. And I'm looking at them, and I was so disoriented for a moment. I'm thinking, how can this be? It's daylight. There's no clouds. There was no wind to my memory. And I'm looking out, and they're just talking as if nothing's going on. And I was like, how can that be? So I'm yelling out. I open up the door. And I'm like, you guys, you know, come inside. And they're just talking and talking. And it was just so unusual. Do you remember that?
Yeah. Because we were kind of in this state of communion. So everything was just part of our conversation.
Yeah. So I'm watching literally the palm trees, the heads of the palm trees touching the ground. And so we decide, you know, I invite them to come inside. I'm like, you guys, let's go inside. And we close the doors and the windows, and we move into the living room. And something came over me, and this is one of the only times that I remember this happening to me, where I just had a sense of knowing what to do. It was very clear. It was like guidance. It was almost like, I mean, I always had a choice, but I felt like I had to. Like it was strong intention to do this. So I had Christopher lie down in the middle. And it was very clear. He was supposed to lie down face up, and Hani was supposed to go and hold his feet, and I was to be at his head. And then what happened after that, I just remember being aware with my eyes, but my body was lifted and my arms were doing things, and I felt instructed to open Christopher's etheric body with a blade or something long. And so you're lying down on the floor, and I remember very, very real to me was to open, for lack of better words, his etheric and physical body, take something out, and then put something what looked like a sword to me in, and then stitch you back up, which is the best way I could describe it, and then hold space for you. And I'm not exactly sure exactly how what happened in that space, but that was like the basics of it. And I just remember how I felt of just being completely like in my knowing about it and the sacredness of us three being together for this, that it was meant to be and that it was important. Mm-hmm. And it felt good. It felt beautiful. It felt uplifting, and it felt complete when we were done. It just felt complete.
And that jingle means our time is up. My thanks again to James, Shay, and Excalibur, and Carol, of course. Happy birthday, honey. I have a little addendum, a little something that happened to me the night after this interview. Well, the night of this interview, but at night. That I'm tempted, of course, to put on the end of this episode, but maybe I'll share it at the beginning. That way it's for non-subscribers and subscribers next week. I'll do that, because this episode is already super long, right? So next week, look for a sort of pseudo-paranormal after-effect of this interview and its potential implications. It's not all that big of a deal, so fair warning. But it is something. So, again, thank you everyone for doing the roundtable, and thank you all for listening. I will see you next week, and if you're a non-subscriber, you didn't hear all of this, so what are you doing? Click that subscribe tab. Get the entire roundtable. Get all of the experience and all of Dreamland commercial-free in their entirety and everything else Whitley has to offer for a pittance. Do it! Do it because you feel pressured. No, don't do that. Do it because you want to and you can afford it. If not, I'll see you next week. Take care, everybody.